leave behind him a blessing, offerings and libations for the Lord your God.
Might become the righteousness of God in him.
The Father made him, Jesus, to be sin.
In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Good evening.
Good evening, Father.
It's good to see so many of you here this evening. This is an important evening for us as Christians, as Catholics, because we're here to publicly say to one another and to the whole world that we're willing to follow Christ on this 40-day journey into the desert, a journey that leads to Jerusalem, a journey that leads to Holy Week and the most important events of the year, our Lord's life, death, and resurrection. And we are here because we want to be part of that. As you know, this is Ash Wednesday, and so we will receive the sign of the cross on our foreheads, which is a public statement of our commitment to this journey, a commitment to change, a commitment to become more like Christ our Lord, to die to those things that still separate us from him so that we can rise to new life come Easter. Let us pause a moment as we begin. Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, that we may begin with holy fasting this campaign of Christian service, so that as we take up battle against spiritual evils, we may be armed with weapons of self-restraint. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Proclamation from the book of the prophet Joel. Even now, says the Lord, return to me with your whole heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your hearts, not your garments, and return to the Lord your God. For gracious and merciful is he, slow to anger, rich in kindness, and relenting in punishment. Perhaps he will again relent and leave behind him a blessing, offerings and libations for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, proclaim a fast, call an assembly, gather the people, notify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children and the infants at the breast. Let the bridegroom quit his room and the bride her chamber. Between the porch and the altar, let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep and say, spare, O Lord, your people, and make not your heritage a reproach with the nations ruling over them. Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God? Then the Lord was stirred to concern for his land and took pity on his people. The word of the Lord. Thank you.
A proclamation from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. My sisters and brothers, we are ambassadors for Christ. As if God were appealing through us, we implore you, on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin, the one who doesn't even know sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Working together then, we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time, I heard you. On the day of salvation, I helped you. For behold, now is a very acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. The word of our Lord.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you,
Lord. Jesus said to his disciples, be on guard against performing acts of religion for people to see. Otherwise, expect no recompense from your heavenly Father. When you give alms, for example, do not blow a horn before you in the synagogues and in the streets like hypocrites looking for applause. You can be assured of this much: they are already repaid. In giving alms, you are not to let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. Keep your deeds of mercy secret, and your Father who sees in secret will repay you. When you are praying, do not behave like the hypocrites, who love to stand and pray in synagogues and on street corners in order to be noticed. I give you my word, they are already repaid. Whenever you pray, go into your room, close your door, and pray to your Father in private. Then your Father, who sees what no one sees, will repay you. When you fast, you are not to look glum like the hypocrites do. They change the appearance of their faces so that others may see that they are fasting. I assure you, they are already repaid. When you fast, see to it that you groom your hair and wash your face. In that way, no one can see that you are fasting, but your Father who is hidden, and your Father who sees what is hidden will repay you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I'm sure that it's happened to many of us as we listen to the Word of God as it's proclaimed with our three readings, Old Testament, usually St. Paul, and then, of course, the Gospel. But hasn't it happened to you on occasion where there is a statement that somehow just strikes you? It happens to me. I just sort of stop in my steps and say, what was that? What was that our Lord said? Or what was it St. Paul had written? Is that really the case? Did I hear right? And that's happened to me. It's happened to me this evening. It happened to me as I was preparing for this evening, because when I come across those words of St. Paul that I'm going to mention in a moment, they cause me to stop every time and say, can this really be? Is this possible? And so we look to those words of St. Paul, which come as about the second sentence in his letter this evening, and he says, for our sake, he, the Father, made him, Jesus, to be sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Imagine what he's saying. Jesus, who is the Son of God, who is holiness itself, there can be no sin associated with God, the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. God the Father made him sin. And not just one sin, but all sin that had ever been committed, that's being committed, that will be committed as long as this world goes on, he made him sin. You say, how is that possible? Another way of putting it is, Jesus is asked to bear the sins of humankind. That explains it a little bit, but nevertheless, how is that possible? And he goes on to say, the reason for it is that we might become the very righteousness of the Father, that we may become a holy people as God is holy. This isn't just another thing that you and I do among so many other things in our lives. It would be nice if we became holy, or I don't want to become holy because then I've got to be different. That's not the issue. We have one goal in life, one vocation in life, one call in life, and that is to be a holy people, as God our Father is holy. And Jesus made this possible by first dealing with the great obstruction, the barrier to holiness, which is sin, selfishness, egoism. That gets in the way. We know that from experience. And so this is the only way it's possible, that if Jesus then would first of all take upon himself the burden of our sins, because we can't do that ourselves, only God can. So he, as the Son of God, accepted that role from his Father in order that we can become once again the sons and daughters of God. And that isn't all. Then there's a conclusion to that. In families, when you're the son or daughter and the folks die, well, then you inherit. Someday your children will inherit whatever it is that you have. You pass it on. And so God assures us of that inheritance, which is eternal life forever with God in heaven and with all our loved ones in heaven. So it all flows very beautifully, but we must first of all deal with this reality that gets in the way, with the obstacles. And that's what brings us here this evening. We're here to acknowledge the fact that you and I still have some obstacles that stand in the way. And we realize that Jesus is here tonight to help us in the process of dealing with those obstacles, so that we can become the sons and daughters of God, the very holiness of God, and inherit eternal life. It all makes sense. It all fits together. And then St. Paul says, as a kind of an added note, working together then, we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain. What I've just said to you is it. It's a grace. It's a gift from God. He doesn't force it on us. God never does that. It's a free gift, and we have a free will, and we can accept it or reject it, but what a tragedy it would be if you and I were to reject it. So St. Paul says, I hope that you will receive the grace of God, not in vain, but willingly, knowing what it's worth, and it's worth everything. Everything. So, that is why we're here. We begin Lent because of what comes at the end of Lent, Holy Week, which is the most sacred time of the year. Not Christmas. Christmas is great. That's great. But Christmas wouldn't have any meaning unless we would go to the very end, why Jesus came. That is to take on the burden of sin, to die for us, as he did, in order that we might live. This is so important. This is so central to us as Christians that we take 40 days to think about it. We take 40 days to prepare ourselves for it. It's just not something that we do overnight. And so then we come to that sacred time of the year because we've taken seriously dealing with these obstacles that still stand in the way. It's a 40-day process, a beautiful process. And so in the gospel, Jesus says today, we don't want you walking around glum and sad and depressed. That's not it at all. Instead, we should be people who are filled with joy, with the thought of what this is all about and where we're headed and what it all means. This should lead us then to a sense of great joy and thankfulness and a willingness to really enter into this process. In the gospel, Jesus suggests those three traditional things that we do during Lent: prayer, fasting, and almsgiving. Prayer, well, I'd like to think that we pray every day. We begin each day, we end each day with prayer. That's a given, okay? But during Lent, to pray with a little more attention, a little more devotion, and maybe a little more prayer too, like opening up the scriptures every day and reading a few lines as a family before the meal in the evening, a few lines from scripture. We have different readings every day in Lent. You can read whatever you want, but if you have that little black book back there, that's another thing that you could do each day as a kind of a prayer together. Fasting. Fasting means saying no to ourselves, that we can say yes to God, and that we can say yes to other people. So the first thing is, well, I'm going to give up candy. And give up candy. Well, that's kids' stuff, okay? I mean, if you like chocolates like I do, then I should give them up, because I got to have my chocolate every day, okay? Otherwise, I'm not fit to live with, but I'm going to give them up. So if I'm in a bad mood, it's because I gave up my chocolate that day. All right, but candy is kind of kids' stuff. We're talking about more important stuff. Getting back to these obstacles again, that's where we have to begin, giving those up. It doesn't pay, really, to do a lot of other things if we're not dealing with the central issue. And so whatever that is, it may be things we're saying that are hurtful, things that we're thinking that may be harmful, things that we're doing that are wrong. And we know that. Well, now's the time. Now's the time to do something about that. It's kind of a liberation period. It's a process, okay? So that's what we're really saying no to. But along with that, we also say no to some of the things we like. Maybe cut back on some of the food. We're eating too much to begin with. Not eating between meals, giving up drinks. I'm talking now not just about milk and water. I'm talking about the more powerful stuff, giving that up during Lent. Whatever. Some of the things that we really like, we're going to say no to for the sake of Christ. And we're doing that not just for ourselves, but also for others. We're going to give up a little time, maybe to help someone, our neighbor, visit a sick person, do something we've always said we're going to do and haven't gotten around to doing it. Time is very precious. So that's where we come to the third thing, which is almsgiving. We have those little rice bowls back there, the loose change that we have during Lent. We put in those rice bowls. That money goes to hurting people all over the world. There's a little brochure in there, a little pamphlet that explains the wonderful work that the Catholic Relief Services does throughout the year, thanks to your and our generosity. So prayer, fasting, and almsgiving as traditional practices during Lent. Think about this evening, the next several days, so that when we get to Sunday, the weekend, the first official beginning of Lent, you'll be ready. We'll be ready to go on that journey to Easter. So then this evening, we're going to come forward to accept the ashes. The ashes are a dead substance. They're not very pretty. They used to be palms, and we burned them. And so we say, from ashes to Easter, from what is lifeless to life itself, the resurrection and the life in our risen Lord, from ashes to Easter. So we got to begin with the ashes in order to journey to Easter. Please rise for our prayer of the faithful. Sorry, we got to have the ashes first. I'm sorry. Okay. We have persons who will assist me in distributing them. If you'd please come forward as you would for communion and then return to your places. Brother Mike has already blessed the ashes this morning during our liturgy, so we will simply distribute them, and along with them you're going to receive a little reminder here, a prayer for contrition, which is certainly in keeping with the spirit of prayer during Lent. Repent and believe in the good news.
As we receive our ashes, let us sing together on page 16, Ashes.
Now we'll have our prayer of the faithful. As followers of Christ committed to our Lenten journey with him to Holy Week and Easter, we ask now for the graces and help we need to be faithful to that journey.
Our response will be, hear our prayer. Lent is a season of almsgiving. Let us pray for the poor, for those who are hungry, for those who are without shelter, for those who are dying for lack of medical care, for those without the opportunity to learn, for those who live with violence, and for generous hearts and creative minds, that we might do our part to alleviate poverty. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lent is a season of prayer. Let us pray for those who do not know God, for those who cannot pray, for those who pray without consolation, for those who pray always and support us in their prayers, and for faithful hearts and quiet minds, so that we might listen to the voice of God within us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lent is a season of fasting. Let us pray for those overwhelmed by too much, for those who eat too much, drink too much, spend too much, and own too much, and hurry too much. For those whose lives are consumed by excess, and for trusting hearts and inspired minds, so that we might reject the temptations of this world and live simply, that others may simply live. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us remember quietly all those for whom we are most concerned. For all those whom we have promised to pray. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us remember those signed in our book of life, and for those we love and miss, and especially for all St. James parishioners, we pray.
Hear our prayer.
God, Heavenly Father, we are grateful for this grace-filled season. May we take advantage of it in every way possible. As we desire to become more like Jesus, your Son, we make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine, work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Accept by you, Lord, may our sacrifice in your sight this evening be pleasing to you, Lord God. My sisters and brothers, may our sacrifice be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and the good of all God's holy church.
As we solemnly offer an annual sacrifice for the beginning of Lent, we entreat you, O Lord, that through works of penance and charity we may turn away from harmful pleasures and cleansed from our sins may become worthy to celebrate devoutly the passion of your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by your gracious gift each year, your faithful await the sacred Paschal feasts with the joy of minds made pure, so that more eagerly intent on prayer and on works of charity and participating in the mysteries by which we have been reborn, they may be led to the fullness of grace that you bestow on your sons and daughters. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Page 11.
Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness, make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the cup and, once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is a chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered together into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Benedict our Pope, Jerome our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Lord's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Jesus.
Let us pray. Pour out a spirit of compunction, O God, on those who bow before your majesty, and by your mercy may they merit the rewards you promise to those who do penance, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Important announcement, there are three kinds of soup tonight, potato, tomato, and vegetable, and I'm told there's a lot of it. So if you don't eat it, somebody else will have to. So please go down to the parish hall, enjoy the soup and some fellowship as well. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This Mass is now ended. Let us go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.
And as we are sent forth, let us all sing together, led by the Spirit, found on page 17, and we'll be singing verses 1 and 4.